from 2002 from until 2003, advanced microcomputer system, etc. Was in Spain as a participant of the study visit an European Union. Sorry. Can I continue?
Can continue.
Okay. He attend course on global strategic leadership for growth and sustainable development at Indian Institute for Public Administration in New Delhi and attended advanced visioning and leadership program on managing human capital and shaping culture organized by TL First Group. TL First Group Institute of Leadership and Management, UK. Dr. Al-Khali attend practical project management course at CCLL Cardiff University in United Kingdom. He was in China Academy of Space Technology or Beijing Institute of Tracking and Telecommunication Technology for now to technology transfer training. Training on CommSat ground segment from 2005. Satellite networking course at PT Telkom Learning Center, Bandung, Indonesia in 2008. Also attend a course on application of engineering economy method for project evaluation on National Center for Technology or Management in Korea. He has attended several international reputable conference, seminar, workshop, course in India, Japan, Spain, England, USA, China, Canada, Wales, Indonesia, Ghana, etc. With published article. While in Japan, he participated in the design and development of electrical power system of arc event generator and investigator satellite, also known as Horyu-4, which was successfully launched into orbit on board H-2A rocket in February 2016. Dr. Akali is a fellow of African Scientific Institute, fellow Institute of Corporate Administration, member Computer Professional Registration Council of Nigeria, member American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. Dr. Akali has interest in energy, technology acquisition and development, R&D, atmospheric physics, solid-state physics, policy-related matters, especially on ICT, science, technology, and innovation, space system engineering, personal mobile and satellite communication, space or tracks activity, energy store, navigation, space and environment testing and interaction, spacecraft design and system integration or payload and bus system, plasma physics, and etc. Brief of the other co-author, Professor Ibrahim Issa Ali Pantami is a professor of cybersecurity and the current Nigerian Minister of Communication and Digital Economy. Dr. Abimbola Alale, she is the Managing Director of Nigerian Communications Satellite in NICOMSAT. Hasana Asuku, she is a Senior Manager in Satellite Control and Operation. And the last, Engineering Ekundayo Obila, is a researcher and astute engineer with NICOMSAT. Okay. Are you ready, Mr. Alkali, to present?
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, if you're ready, the screen is yours.
Okay, I'm going to share the screen right away.
Yes, of course.
I want to recognize all the organizers of this conference, the keynote speakers, Dr. Ting, Katfall, these are my friends. Professor Khairuddin, Professor Agus Zainal Arihin, Dr. Deepak Main, and every single participant that is here. Permit me to stand zoom on the existing protocol. The topic of our presentation, it is communication satellite assets, a tool for national development and socioeconomic growth. This is by my humble self, Dr. Moshood Karim, Hassan Asuku, Babadoku Dantola Mohammed, Jida Ekunda Obamila, Dr. Abimbola Alali. Dr. Abimbola Alali, she's the managing director and chief executive of Nigeria Communications Satellite. She's a lady, one of the strong women that are doing extremely very well in the tech industry in Nigeria. And Professor Isa Ibrahim Ali Pantami is a professor of cybersecurity and the honorable minister of communication and digital economy. And so it's a joint work by the listed people, and I'll be presenting on their behalf. These are the outline of my presentation, role of communication satellite in national development and socioeconomic growth. I'll talk a little bit about NICOMSAT, some of NICOMSAT solutions. I'll talk about navigation and broadband services, direct to home services. Now, when they properly harness communications, is utilized, you know, for us to really do that in developing nations like Nigeria, we have some goals that will drive us in terms of trade and other factors. And the role of communication satellite as a tool for economic growth and national development generally can be summarized into the following broad areas. A tool for modernization and societal integration, a tool for improvement in the nation's productivity and efficiency, a tool for equitable distribution of development, a tool for linking up remote and rural areas. In Nigeria, we have a lot of areas that are underserved and some that are not served in terms of digital presence. So satellite communication is similar to Indonesia, where I've been in Indonesia, we saw how it is done in because of the topology of the area. So the application of communication satellite is very, very vital, critical, and a tool for ease of doing business, a tool for expansion of market opportunities. Now, I'll just look at it a little bit, and I am sure I do not have more than 30 minutes, but again, the slides are already there available. Those that contribute to modernization of a society, these were things that we sat down and did all our analysis based on that implementation is carried out. We look at the quality education of the system, the easy access to information, level of industrialization, societal integration. Now, communication satellite can be a tool for quality education through tele-education. These are things that are practically done through our asset. A tool for information access through broadband connection, internet access, and a tool for industrialization. Now, the second aspect that I said, a tool for improvement of institutions' productivity and efficiency, the productivity and efficiency of government agencies, ministry and parastatal, is very, very critical through digital economy, digital strife, and of the factors which affect their productivity are access to information. How timely are some of this information being accessed? The speed of response to demands irrespective of whatever the situation. Now, communication satellites can bridge this gap. It is. Now, a tool for equitable distribution of development, just as I said earlier on, there are some areas that are not served, some areas that do not have access, some rural areas, but with communication satellite, such kind of this thing can be harnessed. Satellites have the advantage of distance, and you know, because as against the deployment of infrastructures in the case of satellite, because it's a footprint thing, easily it has a wide scope and the footprint, the lessened deployment of terrestrial equipment, as against maybe like cable deployment and so on and so forth. Great importance. And a tool for ease of doing business. Now, availability of good communication makes means of doing business extremely very easy and very speedy. And with good communication, the communication satellite provide, this is extremely possible. And what I'm going to do, I will look at night contact as based on the asset at its disposal. We have a satellite called NIGCOMSAT 1R, and its advantages, its implication, what it does, serves as a tool for modernization and societal integration, a tool for improvement in the nation's productivity and efficiency. These were things I earlier iterated. A tool for equitable distribution of development, a tool for linking up rural areas, a tool for ease of doing business. And when we together, this come up to form the ingredients for national development and socioeconomic growth. That is our target. Now, we've seen some of the impact computer satellite can have us for development. So now for us, we are going to look at Nigerian communication satellites. How are we doing it? Let me just talk a little bit about NIGCOMSAT. Nigerian communication satellite is a government agency, 100% government, and it was established in 4th of April 2006 under the supervision of Federal Ministry of Communications and Digital Economy. We provide innovative and cutting-edge satellite communication solutions, and we manage a geostationary communication satellite. We have backup and agreement with national system, because it's gone international. We are currently providing carrier spectrum management for Belintelsat. These are some of the assets. I'm not going to dwell much on this. So, but the satellite is it's a quad band. It has KU, KAC, and L bands for telecommunication, broadcast, and broadband services. It is at a geostationary orbit of 42.5 degrees east. The launch mass of the satellite was 5,100 kg, and it has a service life of about 15 years. And the infrastructures are in Abuja, Lagos, and somewhere in China called Kashi. We have regional offices for businesses in some cities in Nigeria, Lagos, Kaduna, and Gobe. Now, these are our vision, our mission, our core values. This is a escape of the our satellite. It's, I had already said, it has four C-band transponders. The KU band transponders are 14, A band are 8, L band are 2. It has wide footprint. C band in a COAS 1B, KU band covers some regions in West Africa that's strong foothold. We have a KU band ECOWAS 2B. KU band Asia. We call it Kashi beam. These are some of the footprint. And I will make emphasis on the navigation. It's global. And for us, our attraction have been on navigations where we have a satellite-based augmentation system, navigation products and services, broadband services, e-governance solutions, telemedicine, and tele-education. We have direct-to-home platform and so many other innovations. We are utilizing this critical asset for. And on the navigation services, I would just want us to talk a little bit about the navigation as a means of national development and socioeconomic. We all know that the General Global Navigation Services, everybody knows it's a GPS, which is initiated in 1973. I don't want to go into the details. This is American's GPS. We have GLONASS by the Russians, which was initiated in 1975. And it has over 24 satellites as of 2005. And we have the Chinese Global Navigation Satellite System, which was initiated in 1990. And it has over 35 satellites, which is the full operational capability of 35 satellites. Successful around 2020, and we have Galileo, a full operational satellite. By 2020, we had 24 more are being. Those ones I iterated earlier were global, but there are some countries that have regional navigational satellite system, like India, have the NSS, which is India Regional Navigation Satellite Systems. Sometimes they call it NAVIG. And we have the Quasi-Zenit system, is owned by the. So these are navigation satellite systems, but they are regional, not global, as against the GPS or GLONASS. Now, for us, because these are accessible, because GNSS project is extremely very expensive. If you look at statistics, over $4.7 billion was spent on GLONASS program between 2001 to 2011, and $10 billion allocated to support the system for the period of 2012 to 2020. That's extremely expensive. And in the case of the GPS system, it has got over $12 billion to initially complete, and the running cost per annum is over $750 million. Galileo is as expensive also. India Regional Satellite Navigation System swallowed over $335 million as far back as 2017, and that is only covers a region. Now, I don't want to go into these other statistics, but for us, because of the importance of that, we are keen into utilizing what we call satellite-based augmentation system. And this is only happening because of the NASA-1R spacecraft I was talking about, where the importance of SBAS, it compensates for errors resulting from global navigation satellite systems in terms of integrity and accuracy. The accuracy level that you get from GPS GLONASS or BEDU is not as much as when you have something a little bit where you aggregate some of the errors that you find and to increase your integrity. That explains why we have what we call satellite-based augmentation system and provide continuity and availability. It makes differential corrections of those GNSSs and broadcast such messages. We are doing that through our satellite, which is a geostationary satellite, to give a wider coverage. Now, you have different signal in space from GNSS as against signal in space from a augmentation system. Now, these are just little, not to bore us with, because I'm restricted with time, but I just try to give a wide scope of some of the things that are there. So these are the applications that we are using. The GNSS and SBAS are so many in terms of avoiding clashes. We have what we call geofencing, especially for cattle. We have needs assessment. So many applications. There are so many. Car theft, because you can track them, and you know, and the deformation monitoring. This is also very important for structures, bridges, the aviation sectors. These are statistics. I already submitted this. The slide is with you already. So for us, what we do is harnessing the SBAS infrastructure with this NIGCOMSAT satellite to provide enhanced security, enhanced services generally. So the applications are abound. So these are still in terms of the applications, in terms of geomatics, you know, aviation sector, for precision approach guidance, performance-based navigation, transport system, telematics tooling, fleet management, intelligent transport system, traffic management, timing system, and collision system. These are some of the applications. And in the oil and gas industry, fuel level monitoring, vehicle positioning and scheduling, the applications are abound. Pipeline surveying, leak detection. The military also harness this for some of their operations. On precision guidance, positioning and timing. In agriculture, precision farming. Now, in the case, that is one side. Then utilization of broadband services. Now, just as I said, we have KAs and KU band frequencies that we use for broadband services. We have government agencies, startups, and some private sectors that are utilizing this for internet services and broadband services. So these are some of the way. And we have direct to home DTA services as a tool for societal integration and nation building. information access through broadcasting is very key. Net Council Limited provides a DCA services platform available on KUBAN in Nigeria and some parts of Africa. And in summary of this, NigComSat 1R communication satellite asset is used for telecommunication, broadband, and broadband services. You know, I said earlier on, there are areas where networks, internet, broadband penetrations have not really gone through there. And because of this, what we call national broadband broadband plan, part of one of the key stakeholders in that in achieving that, to widen broadband penetration, to serve everywhere. We want everywhere to be served. There should be no place, there should be no place that is unserved. There should be no place that is underserved. Everywhere should have full penetration. And as a reliable backbone to terrestrial telecommunications system, in that way, national development is attained, is aided. Thank you very much.
Okay. Do you did you finish?
Yeah, I'll finish. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for the nice presentation from Dr. Alkali. So please, for all the participants who want to ask, you can use the reaction in the your Zoom screen. Oh, there are two participants raise hand. Whose name? Rian Agung Laksono. Rian Agung Laksono, do you have any trouble with your connection? Hello? Mr. Rian? Please ask the question. Mr. Rian, are you here? Okay. Then there is a trouble connection. Is there any next participant who want to ask? Okay, maybe we'll move in the chat box. From Muhammad Yuda, permission to ask to Dr. Alkali. The question is, how can a satellite be so sure to reach isolated place?
That's a very good question. Usually, satellites have what we call a footprint, a coverage area. So it is those coverage area that can determine what kind of satellite or when to use the satellite. So you see the difference. I understand the perspective he's asking, as against maybe the terrestrial kind of way, you know, that you need to have fiber cable, a lot of masts. But when the satellite is up there, it has what we call coverage area, ERP, G over T, you know, which can reach everywhere it is designed to reach, everywhere it is planned to reach. So it is not a problem. In Indonesia, mostly satellite is used a lot because of the topology of the area. I was in somewhere Gargar Kalun in Bandung, where most of, if you go to the banks, you go, you see you see a little bit desert installation everywhere, even at ATM positions, because that is a better reach. Does that answer my question? Your question. So it's not a problem. It's a function of the design that is deliberately done to spread coverage. It's not a problem. So it can reach wherever it is designed to reach.
Okay, the conclusion is there is no border with the isolated place to get the information from satellite, right?
No problem, no problem.
Yes, okay. Okay, there is another question from Mr. Pamungkas. The question is, how is satellite role in 5G telecommunication?
That's a very beautiful question. This is the frequency range. I'm going to answer it in two perspectives. We have caliber of satellites that we call high throughput satellite. Throughput is so high, and that can complement the advantage that the 5G that's mostly used in terrestrial now are using, mostly in the region of, I don't know, maybe in Indonesia, maybe it's probably from 3.4 to 3.9 gigahertz. Now, in satellite with HTS, you have such kind of capacity. So it's a complementary effort of 5G flow from mobile operators, terrestrial. I'm talking about not the satellite operators now, and the satellite operators all in the sense that high capacity is attained with cheapness of the resources as a key factor. So it they work hand in hand, a complete handshake. That's a very good question.
Okay, thank you for the nice answer. So, and we have another question from Irfan Maulana. The question is, when satellite orbiting the Earth, it takes 7 kilometers per second. It will make time rotation and make the position and data are not accurate. How could we fix it?
Sorry, I didn't hear that question.
When satellite orbiting the Earth, actually there is time rotation between the source and then the time we get the data. So it makes the data is not accurate. How could we fix it?
No, I think, you see, the data, the integrity of the data is not hammered.
Mm.
Rather, it is the delay, the latency. There is accuracy, but is that delay? Do you understand what I'm saying? And it's not the now. In terms of it depends on what you're looking at. For instance, maybe I should look at it from the point of all kinds of satellites she's talking about. Now, if it is a communication satellite, the delay, the latency is very few. You don't even notice it. Now, if it is in terms of whether any other kind of delay, maybe weather satellite imagery also, the latency is also very small, so there is nothing wrong with the integrity of the information or data, but it is the delay it comes in, maybe some microseconds late. So nothing is wrong with the integrity. Is it clear?
Yes, I think.
Yeah.
So there is no problem about the delay for time.
Yeah, no problem. The delay doesn't affect whatever the information. It doesn't hammer on the integrity of the information.
Yeah, but it's just a little bit. So it's still in the range of, I think, in the good range. So there is no problem.
Mm-hmm. No problem. That's a very good question.
Yes. Okay, this is, there is interesting question from Nurul Umayasari. The satellite can explore the planet Mars or Jupiter. Is it possible? If it's possible, how many years it will likely happen?
Sorry, I didn't hear that. What's the question again?
Is it possible for the satellite to explore another planet such as Mars or Jupiter? And how many years to do happen?
Well, there have been a lot of research ongoing on exploring other planets. A lot. I mean, Elon Musk, the smart guys in SpaceX, they are doing a lot with that. NASA also doing a lot. And India, ISRO, a lot of research are ongoing on, and efforts are on that. So it's yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for the nice answer. Is there any good another question?
Okay. Can I chip in? I have some of my participants, those of us that we co-authored this paper together. Maybe they may want to have something to say. Hassana, Dr. Kalim, and Dantela Ekundayon. Is there anything you people may want to say here?
Okay, maybe one more question.
Okay.
I would like to ask, so what is the main difference between GNSS and GPS? Because in Indonesia, we often heard GPS than GNSS. Could you explore that?
That's a very good question. You see, GNSS,
yes,
Global Navigation Satellite System, those constellations, we have different type. So GPS is also a GNSS, but it's a type that is owned by the Americas. Now, because of this space race, the Russians like, hey, we should have ours. GLONASS. Europeans, ESA, European Space Agencies, they came up with their own platform, which is Galileo. So they are the same, but different proprietary. You understand? It's just like a mobile telephone network. Maybe you have O2, you have like Indonesia, you have different operators. They are different operators. They are all GNSS. GPS is a different kind of GNSS. GLONASS is a different kind of GNSS. So there are different operators. So GPS is owned by the Americans. The Russians are, Americans, they have GPS. I also should have my own kind of GNSS. So they are the same thing. It's like having different telephone mobile network. Do you understand? So the generic name is, GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System. It is global if it can be seen across the world. It is global if it can be seen across the world. Hello? And let me go to my slide. Are we, where is it? Just hold on. Hold on. My slide, I see my slide. I'm sharing it. Where this is GPS by the Americans, they are all global satellite systems. They are different operators.
Wow.
The GPS, they are all the same. And it is GNSS, if it is global, I can see it in Nigeria. GPS, I can see GPS in Nigeria. You can see GPS in Indonesia. It's everywhere. But there are some navigation satellite systems that are regional, like this. This is regional. Indian regional navigation satellite system. They can only see it in India and just their region. And the Japanese, something similar. So it's the same thing, but the coverage is just for their region. Is that clear?
So I think that GPS in one of the part GNSS, right?
Yes, exactly.
So GNSS is more global than GPS?
No, not really. What I'm saying is GNSS, Global Navigation Satellite System, is a navigation satellite system. GPS is a navigation system, right?
Right.
It is global. You can see it different places, not just America only. It covers not just America only. You can see it in Indonesia. I can see it in Nigeria. Then another type of navigation system is GLONASS, that is owned by the Americans, sorry, by the Russians. You can see it in Indonesia. I can also see it in Nigeria. But the thing is, why GPS is mostly known is because most equipment, most equipment that we have, phone, are tuned to access GPS only. Hello? So that's why it is GPS that is very popular.
Mm-hmm.
But it is not only the global navigation satellite system. The others that I've shown on the screen are also global. But we have some fantastic receivers that are multi-frequency, multi-receivers. Now, when we say a receiver is multi-receiver, it can receive GPS, it can receive GLONASS, it can receive Beidou. But most equipments we have today, they are only receiving GPS. That is why we think GPS is the only GNSS. It is not. All these are GNSS. They are as functional as the GPS. But GPS is more pronounced, it's more popular. Is that, do you understand?
Yes, I get the point.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much for your explanation. Actually, there are still many questions that we get, but unfortunately, we already have to end this session.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe I would like to make conclusion from this session with Dr. Alkali.
All right.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Alkali, for your nice presentation. I hope one of us can meet you again in another agenda another time.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure.
But keep still join because we want to make a photo session with you.
No problem. No problem.
Okay. I would like to read the conclusion first. So by using satellite, we will have the advantages such as a tool for modernization and social integration, a tool for improvement in national productivity, a tool for equitable distribution of development, and a tool for ease of doing business. Jadi dengan menggunakan satelit ini akan memudahkan kita dalam berbagai urusan seperti kemudahan dalam mengintegrasikan tele-education seperti yang sekarang terjadi kan ya secara pandemik ini. Jadi penggunaan IT dengan menggunakan satelit itu sangat bermanfaat. Kemudian juga untuk menambah produktivitas nasional. Selain itu, berguna juga untuk distribusi di dalam suatu perkembangan, suatu negeri. Dan yang paling penting adalah untuk membangun sebuah bisnis karena bisnis itu akan berkembang jika sains dan teknologinya itu juga maju sehingga nanti bisa akan menopang ekonomi suatu negara seperti itu. Okay, for all the participants, please turn on your camera because you would like to take the photo. Oh, okay, Mr. Arkali.
Yeah.
Okay. For all the participants, okay, it's ready. Okay, I will count in 1, 2, 3. Next. 1, 2, 3. Okay, next. 1, 2, 3. Give your best smile. Okay. Next. Oh, so we have so many participants today. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. Again, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Why it doesn't move? Oh, okay, already done. Okay. Okay, that's all for today. I personally think all the sessions are running smoothly, and I've got to say that all keynote speaker, participant, the committee are doing beyond great today. So I can conclude that by helping tackle the great challenges facing today's world, such as poverty, disease, and climate change. So it's very important for us to make many collaboration with all scientists over the world with no border and with no exception. Thank you for your enthusiasm. I am Ruk Mutahara as the moderator of this agenda, asking apologize for all the mistakes that I made today. For the next agenda is discussion. So I will leave it to its moderator to take this time. But for the presenter who want to present their presentation, please wait for around 5 minutes because our committee will make the breakout room. Okay, I think this is the last agenda. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you so much for your time. See you in the next MCOS 2022. Thank you, Mr. Muhammad Arkali.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we'll wait for you in Indonesia.
Yeah, inshallah.
Inshallah. Okay, I will close the session by saying Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yes, for all the presenter, please wait for 5 minutes because we would like to break the breakout room. Again, Professor Dr. Muhammad Al-Khali, for the information, we still have the agenda. The agenda is this parallel session. So some of the presenter would like to present their presentation. Maybe if you want to join, we are happy so much.
All right, yeah, I want to join.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Room mana, Bu, ya? Foto kamu pasti menoy. Dari arah lampu awakmu yang kamera itu berapa banyak kan kalau I think I'm very excited.
Oke, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Do you do?
I'm fine, miss.
Oke, thank you. Oke, we have joined in our room session, our room presentation room, the first room. I will continue to sit for a we will learn more about the paper that has been written by the writer. And here we have 6 presenters. I'm sorry, before I will absent first. Here is Mrs. Dahlia Hayati. There in this room. Have you come, Miss Dahlia Hayati? Mr. Agus Wahyudi? Mrs. Novia Utami Putri, here is. Mrs. Maya Puspitasari. Oh yes. And then Mr. Muhammad Putra Pamungkas.
Hadir.
Okay, thank you. And then Mr. Morris. Mr. Morris, are you here? Ibu Dahlia ada di room 2. Oh, wait a moment. I will communicate with the admin. Oke, kita mau pakainya bahasa Indonesia apa bahasa Inggris nih? Karena kita berada di International Conference. Sebaiknya bagaimana? Monggo. Kira-kira bagaimana? Oke, kita pakai bahasa Indonesia saja ya Bapak Ibu, karena mayoritas yang join adalah mahasiswa teknik, mereka masih kurang mengerti untuk penjelasan Bapak Ibu ketika nanti penyampaiannya menggunakan bahasa Inggris. Baik, kita mulai saja untuk yang pertama. Untuk di sesi presentasi kali ini, kita akan memaparkan 6 paper yang sudah dikirimkan oleh peneliti dan penulis pastinya. Dan untuk presentasi kali ini kita ada tidak hanya dari Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama saja, namun berbagai universitas join berkumpul di satu acara yaitu IMCOS International conference. And then
recording stopped.
Untuk presentasi maksimal adalah setiap paper 15 menit. Itu sudah presentasi dan tanya jawab, question and answer. Kemudian apabila dari rekan-rekan partisipan jika akan bertanya atau memiliki sanggahan, boleh mengangkat tangan menggunakan chat box-nya, raise your hand, and then please give your name so that we have enjoy to answer your question like that. Ini campur-campur terusan ya, apa-apa ya. Oke, apa Bu Dahlia sudah masuk di room 1 ya? Belum ya? Oke. Selamat siang Ibu Dahlia Hayati.
Selamat siang Ibu Eni.
Ya, ya di sini saya moderator Ibu. Untuk paper yang pertama akan disampaikan oleh Ibu Dahlia dari Politeknik APP Jakarta ya Ibu, dengan judul Visibility Evaluation of Free Software in Inventory Process in Smart Warehouse. Right. Oke, waktunya 15 menit Ibu, monggo silakan dipaparkan. Dan untuk rekan-rekan peserta, mohon diperhatikan jika ada pertanyaan boleh ditanyakan. Waktu dipersilakan, monggo Ibu.
Baik, terima kasih Bu Eni. Oh, jadi saya pakai bahasa Indonesia nih ya.
Iya, karena tadi anak-anak mintanya, anak-anak, teman-teman mintanya bahasa Indonesia. Padahal kemarin papernya bahasa Inggris ya Bu, monggo.
Baik. Tidak masalah. Baik, terima kasih Ibu Eni. Saya mulai share screen dulu ya kali ya.
Yes.
Belum bisa Bu untuk share screen-nya.
Recording in progress.
Saya komunikasi dulu ya Ibu dengan ini.
Baik. Mungkin saya perkenalan dulu aja kali ya. Sembari
ya, menunggu. Ya, perkenalkan dulu ya.
Ya. Baik. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Perkenalkan, nama saya Dahlia Hayati. Rekan saya pada paper ini ada Bapak Dian Anwar, ada Ibu Subekti, dan ada Bapak Trubainata. Sorry. Alright, oh alright, because Dr. Muhammad Al-Khali is join here. I will use English. I'm really sorry. My apologize. So I have used English. Probably when you.
No problem. No problem. Okay.
I'm so sorry, sir. I didn't know that you already joined in this breakout room.
No. I've joined. It's okay.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
So probably I will use bilingual. If you want to ask me in Bahasa, that's okay. I will ask in Bahasa.
And okay.
Yeah. Especially for Mr. Muhammad Al-Khali, I will present in English. All right. I will start from introduction. My name is Dahlia Hayati, and my
nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Prof.
Yeah.
And then my team member are there is Bapak Dian Anwar, and then Ibu Subekti, and the last one Bapak Atur Bayunata. We are from.
It's my pleasure.
Yeah, nice to meet you, sir. We are from Polytechnic APP Jakarta, one of vocational school under Ministry of Industry.
Okay.
Yeah, our major in logistics, sir. And then right now we will talk about smart warehouse in accordance with free software, open source software.
Oh, because, that's good.
Yeah, because we are really concerned in industry, specifically for a small and medium industry. So we try to give applicable research that can be implemented in small to medium industry.
Oh, okay. That's good. That's good.
All right. All right, I will start my presentation then. Have you seen, already seen my slide share?
Yes.
Right. Sorry. Sorry, there is something wrong with my laptop right now. Please wait a moment. Okay, let me fix. Maybe Bapak Tru, can you help me to present from your laptop? Open my presentation. Oh, all right. Sorry. Oh, Ibu Eni, can you help me to open access for Bapak Atur to share the screen?
I'm sorry.
Can you? Open. I'm so sorry. There is some problem with my laptop.
Oh, Miss. Watch.
Bapak Atur Bayunata will share this slide for me. I don't know why. Few hours ago, it still works, but not now.
Share screen-nya belum bisa. Share screen-nya belum bisa.
Oh, wait a minute. I try once more. Oh, sorry. Probably I have to close my video. Is it okay? If I close my video, then I try to share once more. Slides there. Okay. Right. I already share my slide. Have you seen it? So a few minutes. For the next few minutes, we will talk about the feasibility evaluation of free software in inventory process in smart warehouse. To begin with, this is the outlines, research background, and then research objective, research benefits, methodologies, results, and discussion and conclusion. So, as I mentioned before, research background is about warehouse management system. According to Ministry of Industry, right now Indonesia in Industry 4.0 era, that really need the latest technology in practice. Specifically for small and medium industry, they really need cheap, easy, and reliable technology solution. For research objective, we try to provide alternative technology for industry to support business process in Industry 4.0 and provide opportunities for small medium companies to realize strategy update for their technology. And research benefit for small medium companies as consideration to use free open software source in their organization that can help simplify the warehouse process in smart warehouse and can reduce operating costs regarding technology update. And for education, we try to provide new knowledge about smart warehouse and open source software, where we still need to have exploration to implementing open source software in industry, not only for education. And then for next research, we try to provide input and consideration for further research in logistic and open source software. Right, for methodologies, first, as usual, we study literatures, review journals and book in regarding to logistic and IT, specifically for open source software. And we conducted FGD with IT and supply chain expert about what kind of software that we will use. When we already come up with one open source software, we did mapping process following by questionnaires that were given to IT and supply chain experts, and then we did some data analysis using FMEA. And last thing, we did drawing conclusion and suggestions. Right. For results and discussion, I want to show you, this is the features that provided by two bespoke ERP, which application that we use in this research. Actually, we compare between two bespoke ERP and SAP, system application and processing that we already have in our Polytechnic. So it will be easier to us. And then this is a four-part inventory where smart warehouse can use this application to input all the data for the daily database. And this also can be integrated with AGP. Probably you already know, or I would like to explain that AGP is automatic guided vehicle. Right now, Alibaba already use it. And then this is part inventory. So many features that can be used. Then this is the sample for picking. And then these two bespoke ERP already give a standard for security. So this application already give leveling for permission ID and user ID, also password. Yes, this is how that all the one big dashboard that given by ERP, two bespoke ERP for making a presentation or reports or executive report that will be needed in the end of the day. So when you need one specific report, you can click this box. It will come up with this dashboard for each report. This is just for example. And for questionnaire's results and FMEA calculation, through questionnaire, we get S for severity, that value 2, occurrence 2, and detection 3.5. And for conclusion, RPN around 14, which means two bespoke ERP is highly recommended to be implemented in the industry, specifically for small and medium industry. And this is how quantitative scale for calculating severity, occurrence and detection. For instance, 1 for the best and 10 for the worst. Okay, for economic cost analysis, two bespoke ERP, free for software and implementation relatively. Why I make a relatively in the bracket, because sometimes company need to hire IT if they don't have, but if they already have, it can be considered as free, or yeah, as you know, probably they still need to make preparation for a training or short off. And SAP, as the comparison, SAP quite expensive. We can see through this box, the cheaper one is 2 million per month per user. It means for a year, it's around 24 million. So for conclusion, first, the application system is free, easy to access, and can be downloaded directly in the internet. And then the system runs stably for the simulation that has been done by IT expert and also supply chain expert. And the system also user-friendly or easy system to be used. And then suggestion. First, company organization still need to provide security system to anticipate hacker and virus attack. As you know, the advancement of Internet of Things also make hackers at the same time improving their way to attack or to send malware, ransomware, etc. to disturb your system. And then the second one, for further research, authors can do some quantitative calculation, probably about skill factors. Like I said before, I can't say that this free software really free for the implementation. So we thought that further research need to calculate about skill factor, competencies that will be needed to running these two big spot ERP system properly. All right. This is the end of my presentation. If there is any question, feel free. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Dahlia Hayati from Polytechnic APP of Jakarta. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to ask to Ms. Dahlia, time is yours. Raise your hand, please.
Okay, I have a question.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm yes. Muhammad Alkali from Nigeria.
Yes. My question, Mr. Alkali.
Yeah. The security system, how do you mitigate possibility of hacking? Because since it's an open source software, it's possible to hack. How do you mitigate? How do you control it?
Okay, the question is how we can control this quality software using the free.
Because it is possible for hackers to come in. What do you do to stop hacking?
Oh, hacking.
Attack. Do you have a special malware or antivirus or something to stop hacking? Because it can be hackers can come in. How are you going to do it?
Okay, Ms. Jahlia, Mr. Alkali have a question. How do you do to control the hacking and then or attacking with the using of free software like that, Mr. Alkali? Yes. Miss Dahlia.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Kelly. Yes. Through the research process, we did a vulnerability assessment. Where our IT expert tried to did some tests and assessment. So we use FMAR to calculate about the detection and how to control it. Probably we can use a proxy system. We can use proxy system or antivirus you can install in your computer. And for small industry that doesn't need to use this application online, probably they can use it offline. Actually, for free proxy system, there is Swift proxy system that can be used. And we and also you can install VPN remotely.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. It answers my question. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Alkali and Miss Dahlia. Any else?
Dalam bahasa Indonesia nggak apa-apa. Kalau bingung untuk menggunakan bahasa Inggris ya.
Yeah. Boleh bertanya menggunakan bahasa Indonesia. Waktunya masih ada 2 menit untuk bertanya.
Oh, baik, saya coba jelaskan lagi ya tadi yang ditanyakan oleh Mr. Alkali. Jadi beliau bertanya bagaimana caranya untuk menghindari hacker, kemudian virus. Nah, jadi dalam research kami ini, kami melakukan vulnerability assessment dilakukan oleh IT expert. Kemudian didapatkan bahwa masih ada celah meskipun sudah menggunakan user ID dan password. Lalu bagaimana caranya bisa dengan menginstal proxy. Kalau mau yang gratis, ada Swift proxy system namanya. Kemudian bisa menggunakan VPN. Lalu bisa menginstal antivirus. Antivirus banyak yang gratis. Kalau memang ini kan diperuntukkan untuk small medium industry, jadi untuk IKM, industri kecil dan menengah, seperti itu. Jadi kita mencoba memberikan solusi bagaimana sih agar smart warehouse ini bisa dijalankan, tapi cost-nya lebih murah dibandingkan ketika kita harus menggunakan SAP, seperti itu.
Saya kira ini sistem yang sangat bermanfaat ya Ibu, apalagi sekarang apa-apa menggunakan online, daring. Sekarang online semua. Jadi untuk usaha menengah, kecil maupun menengah itu masih bisa membiayai untuk hal tersebut. Karena seperti saat ini kita di zaman modern menggunakan aplikasi-aplikasi seperti vendors-vendors yang sudah terkenal ya, jual beli aja sekarang online. Kemudian ojek aja sekarang online. Nah, kemudian untuk penjualan pada misal ya ini sedikit ringkasan mungkin ya Ibu. Misal seperti industri kecil kayak PRT, IRT yang memiliki keahlian bikin apa? Punya rajutan di sulam-sulam, sulaman menjadi tas, itu mereka akan jual secara online. Jika menggunakan free software ini kan mungkin akan lebih menguntungkan dan dapat membantu kemajuan dan perekonomian masyarakat. Seperti ini ya, Ibu.
Betul sekali, Bu.
Ya. Jadi teman-teman mahasiswa dan yang lainnya, misalkan ini adalah merupakan terobosan terbaru nih, dan terobosan yang bukan terbaru mungkin ya, sudah banyak yang menggunakan, tapi setidaknya bisa membantu untuk usaha-usaha mandiri.
Mungkin tambahan Bu, karena ini kan untuk inventory juga, bagi yang mungkin tahu untuk warehouse, dalam warehouse ada inventory. Biasanya kalau inventory itu agak sulit ya, misalnya ruang berantakan segala macam. Nah, ini software ini bisa kita gunakan untuk pengklasifikasian gitu, untuk membantu memudahkan dalam pengklasifikasian inventory barang keluar masuk juga. Seperti itu.
Bagus sekali, saya jadi tertarik ini Bu. Jadi tidak sulit-sulit lagi untuk mengetahui barang keluar masuk itu berapa, mungkin kan cost-nya juga akan langsung terlihat di situ.
Betul,
ya, di software tersebut ya.
Betul. Bahkan kalau memang ingin melakukan lebih jauh, bisa kita integrasikan dengan banyak software. Bahkan bisa ke banking untuk pembayaran, dan bisa seperti saya bilang tadi, bisa diintegrasikan dengan AGP yang sudah dipakai oleh Alibaba ya. AGP itu robotik gitu. Itu untuk yang apa namanya next, untuk advance-nya gitu. Cuma untuk yang small medium dia bisa gunakan dengan kustomisasi gitu. Jadi dia memunculkan fitur yang dia butuhkan saja gitu. Karena saking banyaknya fitur di dalam to be spoken.
Setiap mana yang perlu itu yang ditampilkan ya, Bu.
Betul.
Oke. Ada pertanyaan lagi? Ini ada komen, Bu. Saya bacakan dari Muhammad Rifai. Dulu pernah viral data Tokopedia yang bocor. Itu masalahnya kenapa dan bagaimana cara supaya data tersebut aman?
Oke. Okay. Okay. Menurut ya, pendapat saya, sebenarnya ini agak jauh dari materi kita siang ini ya. Oke, tidak apa-apa menurut pendapat saya. Jadi mungkin masuk ke masalah sinkronisasi data Tokopedia yang mungkin masih perlu update data, mungkin enkripsinya juga perlu ada dari Tokopedia, karena ini kita harus lihatnya dari banyak sisi ya. Bisa juga oknum di dalam Tokopedia sendiri. Jadi kita tidak bisa menjudge apa sih yang menjadi masalah dari yang terjadi pada Tokopedia gitu. Karena bukan hanya Tokopedia, bahkan misalnya industri perbankan ya, itu sudah menjadi rahasia umum, data itu bisa bocor kemana-mana. Jadi kita tidak bisa, kita harus melakukan dulu vulnerability assessment untuk mengatakan apa yang menjadi masalah. Karena kan kita science di sini, jadi semuanya harus based on science dan research. Seperti itu. Kira-kira opini saya seperti itu.
Terima kasih Ibu Dahlia. Bagaimana, ada lagi? Saya kira cukup ya untuk sesi tanya-jawab dengan Ibu Dahlia Hayati. Presentasinya sangat menarik sekali, dan materinya pun setelah berbahasa Indonesia saya juga paham, karena saya di luar teknik, jadi kadang ini apa ya, seperti itu. Walaupun baca itu ngerti, secara tulisan saya paham, cuma secara manfaat kurang mendalami. Dengan penjelasan bahasa Indonesianya, insya Allah saya sedikit paham dengan free software dan inventory process in smart warehouse. Okay, next presentation. Thank you very much for Miss Dahlia Hayati.
Thank you very much.
We will continue our presentation from Mr. Agus Wahyudi, MPD. Are you here, Mr. Agus Wahyudi, MPD? Mr. Agus Wahyudi, MPD from STIK Bina Husada. Halo Mr. Agus, where are you? If there is no, we will continue to Miss Novia Utami Putri from Lampung University. Miss Novia Utami Putri. Ibu Novia Utami Putri. there is no Miss Novia, we will continue first for Mrs. Maya Puspitasari from University PGRE of Palembang. Are you here, Mrs.? Okay.
Yes.
Mrs. Maya Puspitasari from University of PGRE Palembang. Under the research title is Analysis of Learning Obstacle Volume Cube in Mathematics Subject for V. Like that, Miss. Oh, for fifth. Sorry, for fifth, not V. Analysis of Learning Obstacle Volume Cube in Mathematics Subject for 5th Grade Elementary School. I'm sorry. Okay, Miss Maya, are you ready for present your paper?
Yes. Sebelumnya mohon maaf gitu, saya tidak terlalu menguasai bahasa Inggris gitu. Jadi mohon maaf kalau ngomongnya campur-campur gitu, Bu.
Oh iya. Oke,
okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh.
Oke, previously I would like to say thank you for INCOS 2021 in University of Nahdlatul Ulama Lampung for this opportunity. My name is Maya Puspitasari. I'm student majoring in elementary school teacher education from University of PGRI Palembang. I'm the first author for this paper. The title is Analysis of Learning Obstacle Volume Cube in Mathematics Subject for 5th Grade Elementary School. I think this research are related for Education Science Department. Jadi mungkin agak kurang relate dengan anak-anak teknik begitu. But I try to present this paper. Okay. Okay, this research, the title of the research is Analysis of Learning Obstacle Volume Cube in Mathematics Subject for 5th Grade Elementary School. I want to present introduction, research background. Mathematics is known as learning that is considered difficult by some students. According to the Ministry of National Education, one of the objectives of learning mathematics in elementary school is to determine the properties and elements of various plate shapes and simple geometric shapes, including the use of angle, perimeters, area, and volume. But unfortunately, in the implementation of learning in the classroom, learning mathematics on the concept of building, especially the material cube of space, is still a difficult lesson for students to understand. This is caused by several student difficulties, one of which is difficulty in carrying out the formula. Okay, next, is student learning a difficulty or different? Learning difficulty can be caused by physical, social, and psychological factor. Brosser revealed that there are three types of learning obstacle. The first is ontogenic obstacle, epistemological obstacle, and didactical obstacle. Jadi, hambatan belajar atau learning obstacle tiap siswa itu berbeda-beda. Bisa dari faktor disebabkan karena faktor fisik, sosial, maupun psikologis. Di sini Brose mengungkapkan ada tiga tipe hambatan belajar yang dialami oleh siswa. Yang pertama itu ontogenic obstacle. Jadi ontogenic obstacle ini yaitu regarding children readiness to learn, maksudnya ialah kesiapan siswa dalam menerima pembelajaran. Kemudian yang kedua, epistemological obstacle caused by the context used when the concept was first learned. Yaitu learning obstacle atau hambatan belajar yang disebabkan karena kemampuan siswa dalam memahami konsep atau materi yang dijelaskan. Kemudian yang ketiga itu didactical obstacle, which are out of the way of learning carried out by the teacher. Yaitu hambatan belajar yang disebabkan oleh penyajian pembelajaran yang dilakukan oleh guru. Oke, okay? Next, learning difficulty will always occur in every lesson, especially in learning that is always considered difficult by student. Various often occur of student relate to learning mathematics, because learning mathematics is a subject that is always considered difficult by student. One of the mathematics learning material that are still a problem in the classroom is the type of geometry building a cube material space. Okay, furthermore, the research also conducted interview with the homeroom teacher of class 5 in one of the public elementary school. The result of the interview revealed that the 5th grade student experienced learning obstacle, including student who did not understand this cube element, student had a difficulty entering number into formula. This is caused by the lack of student interest in learning mathematics, as well as lack of ability of each student in learning mathematics. Another factor that causes student learning obstacle to occur is the use of learning method in the classroom, which are still monotones, namely only the lecture method and assignment. Jadi, pada latar belakang ini, sebelumnya melakukan studi pendahuluan di mana dengan mewawancarai wali kelas, homeroom teacher, mengenai materi kubus di kelas 5 sekolah dasar. Dan hasilnya yaitu dikatakan bahwa terdapat learning obstacle atau hambatan belajar yang dialami siswa. Yaitu siswa belum memahami materi kubus secara spesifik, kemudian tidak dapat atau kebingungan dalam memasukkan angka ke dalam rumus atau mengimplementasikan rumus. Hal ini terjadi disebabkan oleh beberapa faktor, yakni ketertarikan siswa pada pembelajaran matematika itu sendiri dan juga faktor metode pembelajaran yang menurut saya masih monoton. Oke, next. This research is also supported by research conducted by Indasari and Ratna Research, which the title Analysis of Learning Obstacle in Solving Geometry's Problem on Cube and Block. The result of the study revealed that based on the result of the analysis of students, answer the question given, conclusion can be drawn, namely A, question number one contain 43% of students who experience ontogenical obstacle, 40% of students who experience epistemological obstacle, and B, question number two contain 53% of students who experience ontogenical obstacle, and 37% of students who experience epistemological obstacle. Okay, the research benefit this research objective to identify student learning obstacle, so teacher can make a learning strategy to overcome the learning obstacle. Next method, the method used in this study in a descriptive research method that's aimed to describe the student obstacle in learning mathematics based on finding in the field. For subject, this research was conducted by involving research participants, namely elementary school student in the 5th grade of SDN 06 Rantau Panjang and the homeroom teacher of class 5 at SDN 06 Rantau Panjang. Okay, the result of the research is in the study, the learning obstacle analysis was carried out in several stages, namely analysis of diagnostic tests, 2, analysis of interview with teacher, and 3, analysis of the book used during classroom learning. Jadi dalam penelitian ini, identifikasi yang dilakukan yakni dengan melakukan tes diagnostik atau mendiagnosa kesalahan siswa dalam belajar atau hambatan belajar. Kemudian yang kedua dengan wawancara, hasil wawancara dari guru yang mengajar di kelas. Kemudian yang ketiga, menganalisis buku pembelajaran yang digunakan saat pembelajaran berlangsung. Oke, okay. The first of result is analysis of diagnostic test. Diagnostic tests were carried out on 15 grade 5 elementary school students. Identification of student answer in the working out question regarding the volume of the cube is present with the present text in the table. You can see this data in this table. Question indicator number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, di situ bisa dilihat data dari hasil tes diagnostik yang didapat. Di sini mengajukan 5 soal dengan masing-masing indikator dan terdapat beberapa kesalahan, yakni pada soal nomor 1, sebanyak 6,6% siswa salah dalam menjawab soal. Kemudian soal nomor 2, 53,3%. Soal nomor 3, 60%. Soal nomor 4, 80%. Soal nomor 5, 33,3%. Based on the result of the analysis of student answer in table, it showed that A, of the 5 question tests on 20 students, only 2 questions were answered correctly by many students, namely question number 1 and 5 regarding the illustration of the cube shape and unit cube. B, the average number of student experience error in answer question number 2, 3, and 4 with the percentage of incorrect answer being 53.3%, 60%, and 80%. Problem number 2 deal with the element of the cube. Question number 3 deal with the determining the volume of the cube. And question number 4 deal with determining the volume of the cube in story problem. C, student experience difficulty or obstacle in solving problem relate to the volume of the cube, which means student do not understand the concept of the cube and the volume of the cube. Okay, next, the result of interview analysis. The result of interview with the 5 grade homeroom of SDN 06 Rantau Panjang show that the difficulties experienced by student in the cube material when learning in class is a lack of student interest in learning mathematics. Research suspect that is one of research for learning method commonly used by teacher when learning in class. The method that has been used so far is the conventional method in the form of lecture and assignment, which if carried out continuously, makes students feel bored in learning. Okay, next, analysis of the book's use. The result of the analysis of teaching material in the form of math book use in learning in class 5 SDN 06 Rantau Panjang. The research concludes that the material in the book is quite complete when viewed from the theory or understanding. The existing material content for element and properties of the cube as well as the volume of the cube. However, this book provides very few examples of questions that are accordance with the material previously written. The sample questions in the books are also considered quite confusing for students, because the questions that are exemplified are the form of story question with a very high coverage of the material, while the previous theoretical explanation does not disclose the solution formula. Okay, the next is conclusion for the research. Several learning obstacles that arise in student in learning mathematics cube material in class 5 elementary school, amongst other A, Student experience difficulty or obstacle in solving problem relate to element and volume of the cube, which means student do not understand the concept and volume of the cube. Difficulty applying formula for the volume of the cube. Difficulty interpreting story question do not understand the calculation of the volume of the cube. Okay. B, student experience learning obstacle, namely the lack of student interest in learning mathematics and the lack of student ability to calculate, one of which is caused by conventional learning method used by teacher when learning in class. And C, the mathematics learning books use it quite confusing for students because the example of question give are too high and do not match the explanation of the material previously described. Okay, that was the presentation of my research. I apologize if there are many shortcomings. Back to the moderator.
Okay, thank you very much for Ms. Maya Puspitasari. She have presented her paper analysis of learning obstacle volume cup in mathematics subject for fifth grade elementary school. Okay, jadi di sini analisis tentang
materi kubus, hambatan belajar
materi kubus. Hambatannya ya, hambatan ini di analisisnya menggunakan apa ya, Bu? Pertama di tesnya menggunakan diagnostik, yeah. Tadi diagnosa, yeah.
Yang pertama itu materi menggunakan tes diagnostik.
Materi tersebut yang buat siapa?
Untuk materi
tes diagnostiknya tadi, apakah sudah ada lembaga yang menyediakan ini tes yang sebaiknya digunakan atau disusun oleh Ibu Maya sendiri beserta tim atau bagaimana?
Ya, jadi untuk tes itu sendiri ini disusun oleh saya sendiri beserta pembimbing dan juga setelah itu divalidasikan ke dosen yang relate dengan pembelajaran itu sendiri.
Jadi disusun oleh Ibu Maya beserta tim dengan pembimbingnya, kemudian
diimplementasikan atau diuji cobakan ke siswa.
Diuji cobakan, kok. Kemudian hasilnya bagaimana, Bu? Apakah kesulitan siswa itu benar-benar sekian persen siswa memang kesulitan dalam menguasai materi kubus atau bagaimana?
Iya, jadi untuk tes diagnostik sendiri itu dilakukan kan di kelas 5. Jadi untuk berdasarkan studi pendahuluan yang dilakukan yaitu dengan interview dengan wali kelas yang bersangkutan gitu. Jadi dibuatlah tes, kemudian diuji cobakan kepada siswa. Dari uji coba tersebut didapatkan data dari tabel tadi, yaitu, ya. Saya izin buka dulu Bu ya.
Ya.
Yeah, can I make a comment? Can I make a comment? Hello.
Yes, Mr.
Yeah, I really, really, really like your presentation. But I so much enjoyed it. And how long did it take you to make this effort? How long? It's a strong research, it's a very good one. It for a semester or two semesters, or just for a few days?
Mohon maaf, boleh
Mr. Alkali?
Hello, I am
excuse me, Mr. Al-Khali. Yes.
Okay.
Repeat please, Mr. Al-Khali, what's your question or your ini? Your comment for Mrs.
I
Maya.
Said, how long? It's a beautiful research. Hello. Hello.
Oh.
Hello.
Berapa lama sih melakukan
research? Hello,
yes,
I'm
yes,
back.
Mr. Al-Khali.
Yes, I said I really love the presentation from Maya. It's a good one. I'm curious, for how long did she do this research? Is it for 2 months or a semester? And the data, and especially on how she has to identify the different obstacles. It's a good one. Very, very good presentation. But I'm just curious. I want to know how long did it take her? Her data, is it for, did she work for 1 semester or for 1 year? How long? Do you understand my question?
Berapa lama sih melakukan penelitiannya gitu, Mbak Maya?
Oh, iya. Terima kasih atas pertanyaannya. Untuk pakai bahasa Indonesia nggak apa-apa, Bu ya.
Oke.
Untuk penelitian ini dilakukan selama 1 bulan gitu. Karena ini hanya mengidentifikasi dari data di lapangan. Kemudian dari sekalian saya jelaskan yang tadi, Bu ya. Dari data yang sudah dikumpulkan itu menghasilkan hasil tes diagnostik yang ada pada tabel pada slide PowerPoint ini. Untuk soal yang diberikan itu 5 soal terkait dengan materi kubus berdasarkan studi pendahuluan yang telah dilakukan sebelumnya. Jadi soal yang dibuat itu berdasarkan hasil interview dengan guru yang ada di sana terkait dengan hambatan belajar. Nah, di dalam sana juga dilihat dari kurikulum 2013 tentang materi apa saja yang dipelajari di kelas 5 itu, kemudian dibuatlah soal, 5 soal untuk melihat learning obstacle atau hambatan belajar tadi. Nah, dari 5 soal tersebut, ternyata hanya 2 soal saja yang sedikit sekali siswa itu mengalami hambatan, yakni pada soal nomor 1 dan soal nomor 5. Nah, hal ini dilihat dari banyaknya siswa dapat menjawab benar dari soal 1 dan juga 5. Kemudian pada soal nomor 2, 3, dan 4 itu terlihat banyak siswa yang tidak dapat menjawab soal. Macam-macam, ada yang tidak tahu rumus, ada yang tidak menjawab sama sekali, dan juga ada yang kesulitan dalam berhitung. Karena menurut interview atau wawancara dari wali kelas itu, siswa itu memang kurang tertarik dengan pembelajaran matematika. Karena ya mungkin pembelajaran matematika itu sendiri sering sekali dianggap sebagai pembelajaran yang paling sulit gitu. Pembelajaran yang sebagian siswa tidak menyukai seperti itu. Banyak yang mungkin tidak paham, kemudian langsung menjudge bahwa matematika itu membosankan. Nah, jadi dari ketidakada minatan siswa terhadap pembelajaran matematika itu sendiri, maka menurut guru tadi, siswa dalam hitung-menghitung itu sangat kurang seperti itu. Jadi, hambatan itu merupakan salah satu hambatan belajar. Kemudian setelah analisis dari tes diagnostik, saya melakukan wawancara lagi dengan guru. Wawancara terkait dengan spesifikasi hambatan belajar di SD tersebut terhadap materi kubus ini. Nah, dari hambatan belajar dari hasil wawancara tersebut didapatkan bahwa hanya sekitar 50% yang menyukai pembelajaran matematika. Kemudian ketika ditanya metode yang digunakan dalam pembelajaran itu sendiri tuh masih konvensional atau masih monoton dengan ceramah dan juga penugasan. Sementara di dalam pembelajaran di SD itu sendiri banyak sekali metode maupun model pembelajaran yang seperti dengan permainan dan juga banyak sekali diskusi kelompok dan lain sebagainya yang bisa digunakan sehingga pembelajaran itu akan menjadi lebih menarik dan meningkatkan minat siswa dalam pembelajaran. Jadi pada intinya penelitian ini dilakukan selama 1 bulan seperti itu.
Oke, okay, thank you Miss Maya. Oke, okay, Mr. Alkali, she have reached his research in a month using the to get the data and then the research method on using the validity for the his her teacher or her lecture in her university, and then the result is the data to know the learning obstacle using the interview with the teachers and then the and the result the student does not interest learning math until 50%, so that their learning math is so low like that, and the teacher is still using traditional method like that. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Alkali, okay. And Miss.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank
Miss
you,
Miss Maya. Any other question? Thank you, Miss Maya. It is a good presentation and smart to be the next presenter on the next moment like that. Okay, we will continue our presentation today. You for Miss Novia Utami Putri from Lampung University. Are you here?
Hello.
Okay. Please welcome Miss Novia.
Can you hear my voice?
Yes, I can. We can. Miss Novia Utami Putri from Lampung University will present her paper under title Frequency Stability Control in Low Inertia Power System Using Virtual Synchronous Generators. Okay, Miss Novia, time is yours.
Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Yeah, hello, Mr. Akali. I hope you enjoy my presentation.
I did. I enjoyed it very well. Beautiful presentations.
Okay. Yeah. Let me introduce myself. Okay, my name is Novia Utami Putri. I'm from University of Lampung, and I want to present my paper is Frequency Stability Control in Low Inertia Power System Using Virtual Synchronous Generators. Okay, share screen. This my paper and with my lecturers are Mr. Hayrudin and Ms. Nining Puwasi from Electrical Engineering University of Lampung. Okay. Okay, introduction. In an electric power system, frequency is an indicator of balance between the power generated and the total system load. System frequency will drop in case of undergeneration of overload. The decrease in the frequency that large can result in failures of generating unit series that causes a total system's failure. Partial load released automatically by using a virtual synchronous generator can prevent frequency drop and return to desired frequency check normal. One of the characteristics of an electric power system that is very important for maintenance stability is the frequency. The importance of keeping frequency closely related with efforts to provide quality energy source for consumers. Energy supply with good quality frequency will avoid equipment consumers from damage easily range only 50 to 60 hertz. Frequency control is not only to satisfy customer action also and to maintain the stability of the system. Then every object has the ability to defend itself from the disturbance given to it. For object that move horizontally, the magnitude of the ability to defend themselves is influenced by mass. As for a rotation object, the ability or tendency to defend itself depends not only on mass, but also on the moment of inertia. An object that has a greater moment of inertia has a higher ability to defend itself. Generator is a rotating object that has a moment of inertia. One of the factors that affects the rate of decrease in the frequency of generator is the inertia constant. The greater the value of the inertia constants, the ability of generator to defend itself in the face of disturbances. In this case, the frequency response to overload due to the solar cell and wind turbine connected to the load and the grid is not able to flow electricity optimally, so that inertia is low in the system. Frequency stability depends on the ability to restore balance between load and generation system by minimizing load shedding. So what is the inertia? Look at the figure. The inertia is the generator to resist change to its state of motion. The inertia is between the synchronous motors which drive the synchronous generators, like a flywheel which drives the synchronous generators at a constant speed proportional to the frequency of the power supply. The generator output voltage is regulated by a voltage and frequency regulator, which is constant and proportional to frequency of the power supply motor. When the input power is momentarily lost or degraded, the flywheel supplies that store energy to the generator and the frequency is maintained within the desired tolerance for a duration depending on the flywheel's inertia. These have two figures, figure A and figure B. This is conceptual structure of VSG or virtual synchronous generator. The VSG consists of three fundamental components. Look at the figure A. It consists of energy source, inverter, and a control mechanism. The VSG serves as an interface between a primary energy source and the grid. In the VSG control block, generally a dynamic function similar to the swing equation of the SGS is embedded that determines the output power based on the grid measurements and their rate change. And the figure B show a more detailed structure of VSG control inverter. It showed the connection diagram of three-phase inverter with VSG control. The measure signals are the line-to-line voltage. The symbol is VUV and VVW. That is near the transformer and line currents. this is IU and IW symbolic, and VPN represents the voltage of the DSL. So in so this is symbolic from get from the battery. The pulse width modulation, the pulse width modulation, or PWM signal, or we can call it PWMU, PWMV, and PMW, PWMW are calculated in the VSG control and sent to the bridge inverter. The arrows at the measurement points indicate positive directions. In this system, the voltage is measured at the grid side of the transformer. The inductor current is measured or used to prevent overcurrent. Although the value of system current at the source side of the transformers is the difference between the current flowing into the filter capacitor and the inductor current. The current in the small filter capacitor is negligible and can be ignored. The inductor current is then equal to the system current. So this is a design before simulation with MATLAB Simulink. We have three generator for each half parameter. Parameter generating capacity, transformer capacity, and load capacity. And VSG usually plus between renewable energy source. So VSG, the plus in the renewable energy source in photovoltaic and wind turbine. Okay, the DC source goes to the VSG by providing inertia and damping that supports the grid system. The conventional generating capacity, transformers, and load. Okay, grid. Generating capacity. We have three grid. G1, G2, and G3. Half parameters. On the first grid is 192 MVA. The parameter frequency each grid are 60 Hertz, and the second grid half parameter is 128 MVA, and the last third grid is 247.5 MVA. And then for the transformer capacity, first trafo, second trafo, and third trafo. Okay, parameter, desired parameter for the voltage, standard voltage 230 kilovolts, and the parameter have to 60 Hertz. And load capacity for each load A, B, C, load A 125 megawatt, load B 90 megawatt, and load C 100 megawatt, and also parameter frequency are 60 Hertz. Okay, these result and analysis result after design, we simulation with MATLAB, so application, and I take a part of design. So I take bus 1, 5, 6, and 8, because for example, bus 1 near 4 generator, I choose the one, and bus 5, 6, and 8, because near the low. So we can compare the result. Okay, the table, we can get the data in the table. In bus 1, the lowest frequency oscillation is 59.88 Hertz at 0.02 second, and the highest is 60.27 Hertz at 0.1 seconds, and stable again at 60 hertz, but at 0.3 seconds, generator is only the capacity of each different generator to supply electrical energy to the load, so there is sufficient, so there is a change in the frequency value, but does not affect the system significant. And in bus 5, 6, and 8, the lowest frequency oscillation at 0.02 seconds are 59.85 hertz and 59.88 hertz, then 59.88 hertz, and the highest at 0.50 seconds are 60.28 hertz at 60.28 hertz, and then 60.07 hertz and 59.88 hertz, and stable again at 60 hertz at 0.3 second. Okay, why? Because on the bus 5, 6, 8, there are the distribution network resulting in frequency oscillation for some time, but it does not affect the distance significantly. So frequency response on each bus is a nominal condition where there has not been a significant. Okay. No additional arrest or VSG. Okay. Next, result and discussion about IEEE in main bus frequency with renewable energy source or RES without VSG. So I put a renewable in the network, in the system, and also to in bus 1, 5, 6, and 8 or for analysis. So we can look the table. You can see the table. So we compare each result from simulation. Yeah. On the bus 1, okay, the system able because connected near first generator in capacity of 198 MVA. So it's not the doesn't matter. On bus 5, 6, and 8, the frequency respond the highest oscillation and the lowest oscillation in table. We can see the table, and then at the 0.3 seconds to the 0.4 seconds, the frequency value returns to the 60 hertz position. But as in the frequency oscillation occurs continually until the 1 seconds, because the total inertia in the system decreased by up to 20% due to addition of RES, which does not have inertia and is unable to the load requirements, which causes load sheddings, so the system is difficult to stabilize the frequency in a fast time. Next, the last result, IEEE 9 bus frequency with RES and VSG. So we compare before the figure before. On bus one, the frequency response highest 60.15 hertz at the 0.04 seconds, and the lowest oscillation 59.82 hertz, and then on bus 5, 6, 8, And for the highest oscillation and lowest, we can see the table. And at the 0.3 seconds, frequency can able to return the nominal frequency to 60 Hz. But the frequency oscillation is fluctuating up to the first second. And then frequency, so the frequency value have to decrease up to 60%, and VSG can to maintain system stability even though the frequency oscillation remains rotating by returning time faster than without VSG. That's my conclusion. The frequency response on the IEEE 9 bus with RES has decreased from the total MC to 20% of the system due to the frequency instability from overload, so that the oscillation frequency continues to damage the electrical components in the system. And when VSG is connected to RES on the IEEE 9 bus system, there is no significant difference both of them, but VSG can stabilize the frequency in a fairly fast time compared to without VSG in the system. There are my reference for my paper. Okay, finally, this my presentation. Hopefully it will be usable for all of you. Thank you for your attention. And back to the moderator, please.
Okay, thank you very much, Mrs. Novia Utami Putri. Nice presentation and about engineering, right? Yeah, I'm yes. So confused.
Okay, sorry.
It's not my material. I don't know what do you say. Bukan bidangnya.
Systems, conversion energy system.
Okay, jika ada pertanyaan, if any question or comment. Mr. Alkali, maybe. If there is no, I think it's so good presentation. It's complete. If there is no, I think enough for Miss Novia, and then we will continue to.
Mungkin di bahasa Indonesia kan kali ya, Miss ya.
Gimana, Bu? I can unmute. I'm sorry, Mr.
Ya, mungkin Mr. Akalinya I can unmute. atau saya terjemahkan sedikit ya, Mbak, bahasa Indonesia ya, Bu ya.
Tapi waktunya sudah
mungkin,
ini.
Halo.
Mohon maaf kepada Hello? Mas Pamungkas untuk di unmute dulu.
Halo,
Mr. Alkalini. Saya nggak bisa. Co-host, please help me. I'm sorry, Mr. Alkalini. May you write on the chat. What's your comment?
Hello, it's okay now, right?
Okay.
Yeah, I had network. I was logged out and I tried coming. Oh. I like this presentation so much, but I have a question. When to the presenter, the generating capacity, when she was talking about the grid of 192 VA, it's too small, right? Is it MVA or VA? Generating capacity, is it 192 VA or MVA?
Okay. Can I answer?
Yes, Novia. Yes.
Because if it is VA, I think it's small. I thought you should. Maybe I didn't see it very well. You know, I missed the slide a little bit. Yeah, you can answer. And okay. The other question in your results and analysis. I had wanted to see what are the criteria you use in choosing the buses. If you go back to your results and analysis in selecting the buses you use, buses one or buses two or buses five, what are the criteria you used? Some are close to the load or some are far away from the load. So these are two observations. Hello.
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 Yes, Mr.
Did you get my questions?
Yes. The last question I not can hear.
Okay, I repeat. I said. Hello. I will repeat my question. Your generating capacity. Hello. Hey. Can you hear me?
Yes, Mr. Alkali.
Yeah, your generating capacity. I'm not sure. Was it VA? Because if it is 192 VA, that is a little bit too small. Is it MVA? I missed it kind of, and I guess the frequencies are 60 hertz. That is on one side, and the second question. When you are selecting the buses, you know, you had about one, two, three, about five buses. When you were selecting the buses, what criteria do you use in selecting some of the buses? Is it because they are close to the load, or maybe there are other factors? Maybe can you just explain again?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. So the first question. Generated capacity. I have to explain. MVA is megavolt ampere.
Oh, so, is megavolt? Oh, good. Fine. My mistake.
So
I thought
generated.
Oh, that's good. That's big. All right. Then can you go to your result and analysis, the slide.
So, why I choose four bus? Yes, Mr. Alkali.
Yes, why you selected?
Why I choose for the bus or for result and analysis?
Yes.
In actually, my research, each bus
yes.
I analyze for my research. In bus 2, 3, 4, 7, and 9.
Okay.
Mirip toh apa toh mirip? Like the value not far from the bus 5, 6, and 8, and I choose the bus one. The part for example. Example for bus 2 and bus 3. Near the generator. Generator 1 and generator 3.
Okay.
Too much. I explained this paper.
Okay. I understand. That's good. I understand. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Arkali.
You have answered my question. Thank you very much. You've answered my question.
Thank you, Mr. Arkali.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Novia, for your times, and we will continue to. Before Mr. Agus Wahyudi, are you here? Are you in the room? Okay.
Thank you, Ms. Amy.
Yes, you're welcome. For the next presenter is Mr. Muhammad Putra Pamungkas from Nahdlatul Ulama Lampung University. And the paper title is Device to Device Communication Power Control for Interference Management in Existing Cellular Network. Okay, Mr. Muhammad Putra Pamungkas, are you ready?
Thank you. Is my voice clear?
Yes. Okay. Mr. Muhammad Putra Pamungkas, time is your for your presentation.
Thank you very much. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, in this change occasion, I would like to present my research with my college about device-to-device communication power control for interference management in existing cellular networks. So the background of this research is, as we know, the mobile communication is increasing time by time. So by the increase of the information and communication by mobile, the large bandwidth can deliver, we need a more bandwidth to deliver more information. So based on 2016 data collected by Association of Indonesian Internet Service Provider or APG, there is increase of about 88 million penetration to the internet compared to 2014 and 63.1 million penetration which are mobile users. So the channel with the increase of the penetration, the channel, the pipe of telecommunication becomes full and the network service performance will decrease. So there some researcher develop a new protocol communication between mobile, that is device to device communication. Device to device telecommunication is a technology that allows user to interact with each other directly bypassing the BTS as the conventional telecommunication network on mobile. So the that between device is directly communicating without using base transceiver station. And one of the challenges of using this technology is the interference that caused by day-to-day communication and conventional cellular communication. So this research will focus on management interference by controlling the power output of the device, either it is device to device capable or traditional cellular device. So this is the illustration about how device to device capable devices, D2D device, interference the conventional mobile component. In the right, in the left, this is the downlink period. So when the mobile user equipment communicating with device with BTS, base transceiver station, the device to device capable, especially device to device day to day transceiver, will interference the signal come from BTS to the mobile user equipment. And while the upload period in the right, the octagonal on the right, when mobile equipment, user equipment send signal to BTS, the D2D-R device will interference the signal. And so between the device-to-device capable devices will communicate directly. Here is the link, the navy one, and the red one is the interference link, and the green one is between MUE and A0B or BTS link. This research has been done by several researchers. The first is device as reference device discovery process using the PROSE algorithm. This research was conducted in three different scenarios. And then the interference management using ISA or interference suppression area algorithm by Guo and Tan 2014. And then the Melo et al. 2015 SDPC. This is a method algorithm of the power control gives better result other than open loop power control scheme in interference management. And then Lilin and et al. Using the centralized power control scheme to improve the cellular network performance with the consequence of using resource D2D devices. And then Abadi in 2017 concluded that the power control method could significantly improve the network performance in between D2D devices and conventional devices. So this research methodology using MATLAB as the simulator, first thing to do is generate the ecosystem, generate the environment between where the single cellular, single BTS, and single mobile user equipment or MUE generated with several G2D pair. So, and then we calculate the distance between UE and BS base station, and then between D2D and between D2D and UE and BS. And then we calculate also power gain between UE and BS or BS to UE. And then we calculate the interference. The QoS we are measure here is SENR and throughput. And then the parameter for the cellular specification is likely in the table one. And then the algorithm we use to control the power, the first algorithm proposed is adaptive power control, where where the D2D devices will lower their power transmit by 1 min/mdB if a device of the 2D pair less than 500 meter, they will lower their power transmit by minus 1 dB. And then we calculate the QoS and then fixed power control. Fixed power control means the device to device pair will, all the D2D device will lower their power transmit by minus 1 dB, 1 dBm, and then calculate the QoS. So the results we got is the frequency used by the MUE device in conventional cellular network is the same as frequency used in the 2D communication. So there will always significantly interference. We can see here the star line is SENR without the power control or the original result, and then the triangle one, the triangle line is power SNR using after we use the adaptive power control, where the device D2D device less than 500 meter from MUE will lower their power by minus 1 dBm. And the circle line is using the fixed power control. So all the D2D device will lower their power by minus 1 dBm. From the result, we got the cumulative distribution of SCNR value in downlink period. This we know, we can see the black line. We see at the 80% of the probability, black line is SCNR without power control, around 34. So the smallest is SCNR. This is minus dB. Here the with adaptive power control, the blue line adaptive power control, and the yellow line is the fixed power control. The result, the average of QoS value in downlink period can be seen as the without power control, SCNR value is about 34.29 dB, while the throughput around 51.41 megabit per second. While using fixed power control, the SCNR value around 34.45 dB, and the throughput around 51.47 dB. While using adaptive power control, the SCNR value around 34.35 dB, and the throughput is 51.40 Mbps. So we can see in this downlink period, the power control algorithm proposed is actually gives impact to the system, where the fixed power control did the most impact with the largest SCNR and the largest throughput. Secondly, the adaptive power control, and then the last is without power control. So here, fixed power control is give result better than adaptive power control algorithm. And then in the uplink period, the same result can be seen, where the fixed power control algorithm gives better result from the other power control algorithm. So we can jump to the average QoS. Here the power control scenario, and then the value, the average value of SCNR adaptive power control is 2.13 dB, while the fixed power control is 1.6968 dB. In the result, adaptive in the period, the uplink period, algorithm adaptive power control algorithm gives a better result than the fixed power control algorithm. This is different from the when downlink period. this is our conclusion. Overall, the schema of the fixed power control has a better QoS parameter improvement than the scheme of the adaptive power control. The higher the number of interference, the lower the HNR value and throughput. So the power control method from interference management by controlling the transmit power of the interference device. And then the interference management using the power control algorithm is able to improve the HNR value and increase the throughput value. Okay, this is our research. Any question?
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you, Mr. Pamungkas. If there is any question or comment, time for participant, maybe Ms. Dahlia, Mrs. Novia, Mr. Arkali. About interference management, interference management in existing cellular network. If there is any comment, there is no.
So let me resume our presentation in bahasa. Jadi riset yes. kami adalah tentang.
I'm sorry, Mister. No more than 5 minutes, okay?
Okay, thank you. Maybe Mister Alkali.
Oke, kalau itu saya tanya bukan materi Pak.
Yes.
Device to device or D2D. D2D singkatan ini sudah dari sananya atau dibuat-buat sendiri oleh Pak Pamungkas nih. Device to device, device to device.
Right.
Singkatan D2D-nya dibuat-buatannya Pak Pamungkas sendiri atau memang dari teorinya memang singkatannya seperti itu?
Ya, jadi device to device ini memang sudah standar baru yang dikeluarkan oleh lembaga yang berkaitan tentang telekomunikasi. Salah satu punya, disingkatnya memang singkatannya memang D2D seperti itu.
Singkatannya D2D.
Sudah standar, ya standar.
Karena saya mikirnya kok D2D harusnya berarti ada 4D. D kan gitu. Yeah. Makanya saya nanya ini singkatannya kalau sudah dari lembaga berarti kan ya sudah atau kalau memang buatan inspirasinya Pak Pamungkas mungkin perlu direvisi gitu. Yeah. Kalau sudah dari lembaga yang bersangkutan berarti kan sudah akurat.
Standar has been standard since 2013. So D2D is one of key feature in LTE and 5G network.
Okay. Any commenter next? If there is no commenter or question, I think enough, Mr. Pamungkas. Thank you very much for your presentation, and I will Mr. Agus Wahyudi, Mr. Agus Wahyudi, or Mr. Morris, Mr. Morris Triple S Tumanduk from University of Manado. Mr. Maurice Tumandu. No one here, Mr. Agus and Mr. Maurice. Karena Bapak Agus Wahyudi dari STIK Bina Husada dan Bapak Maurice Tumanduk tidak hadir di room, kita akhiri acara kita siang hari ini. Dan dimohon untuk kembali ke room pertama.
Foto dulu enggak?
Pertama untuk foto dulu enggak? Oh, foto dulu, Pak. Yang foto Pak Pamungkas aja deh.
Ya, mungkin boleh teman-teman presenter yang lain juga ikut on camera.
Untuk laporan di bukti.
Satu, dua, tiga. Oke, ini ada empat slide. Mungkin slide berikutnya ada yang mau foto. Empat halaman. Oke, cukup.
Oke. Thank you very much for your attention and your coming in room one. Our moment today is presenting your paper, your research paper. I'm so sorry if I have if I have any mistakes. And wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Oh ya, yeah. Maaf Bapak Ibu yang presenter hari ini, Bapak Ibu Dahlia, Ibu Novia, Ibu Maya, dan Bapak Putra Pamungkas, mohon isi absensinya ya, untuk yang bukan presenter tidak diperkenankan untuk mengisi karena sertifikatnya berbeda presenter dan non presenter. Nanti hanya membedakan untuk sertifikat saja, jadi audiens tetap mendapatkan sertifikat, cuma isinya berbeda. Terima kasih, mohon kembali ke main room. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Recording in progress.
Selamat sore para peserta. Selamat datang di room utama. Mohon tunggu sebentar karena pengumuman best paper dan best speaker akan kami infokan. Mohon untuk yang masih di room 1 dan room 2 agar dapat kembali ke room utama. Good afternoon. Well, future agenda is announcement for best paper and best speaker. Assessing this point of paper and speaker was done by LLDT Region 2 team and all member of UNU Lampung. Ladies and gentlemen, best paper and best speaker in this IMCOS 2021 agenda is follow. The winner best paper and best speaker, Dahlia Hayati from Polytechnic APP Jakarta. Please give applause for the winner. And please give applause for all presenter. You are the best. And thank you so much for all presenters who has joined in this event. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is the last agenda for the international seminar, the first international multidisciplinary on science and technology 2021. Future the next agenda is praying to Bapak Nur Kaif, SPD, MPD. Please, pleasure.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ala hadhihi niyah wa ala kulli niyatin sholihah. Al-Fatihah. A'udzu billahi minasyaitonir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin arrahmanir rahim maliki yaumiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alaihim ghairil maghdubi 'alaihim waladdallin. Ya dzal jalali wal ikram, a'udzu billahi minasyaitonir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Asyhadu an la ilaha illallah wa asyhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. Allahumma shalli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa sallim wa raddi wa tabarakan kulli sahabati Rasulillah ajmain. Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin. Hamdan syakirin, hamdan na'imin, hamdan yuafi na'mahu wa yukafi umazid. Ya Rabbana lakal hamdu kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhika karim wa 'azimi sultanik. Allahumma ighfir li wali walidayya warhamhuma kama rabbayani shighara wa li jami'il muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya'i min wal amwat innaka la kulli syai'in qadir. Rabbana dzalamna anfusana wa illam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna minal khasirin. La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu minadz zalimin. Allahumma arinal haqqo haqqo warzuqna tiba'a wa arinal batila batila warzuqna tinaba. Rabbana atina min ladunka rahmah wa hayyi lana min amrina rasada. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina adzabannar. Wassallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin nabiyil mi wa ala alihi washabihi wa baraka wa salam. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wassalamun ala mursalin, alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wallahul mafiq ila aqwamitor. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you very much, Bapak Nur Kaif, SPD, MPD. Ladies and gentlemen, we are really appreciate and thank you for all participants and presenters from various universities. I would like to say thank you especially for LLDT Region 2 who facilitated this UNU Lampung for this international seminar. And finally, happily, we'll get the benefit from these activities. We say so sorry for all of mistake in event. Thank you very much, and I see wallahu muwaffiq ila aqwamit thoriq. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.